Hello and welcome to the Pixel Shed podcast for the not the week of whatever the week is, because it might go up a little bit late. You don't know. You don't know when these things go up, Daddy.
Okay.
You don't know.
Caught me off guard.
I did.
I was playing Trump Dump.
Trump Dump. Ollie Saville's here this week because Jacob is away on...
I'm usually here.
Yeah,
you're not here usually. Because Jacob's away.
No.
I'm just here and Jacob's away.
And Jacob's away. Last week you weren't here. We had Gregor Smith and Alex Sheldon on.
I wasn't here last week.
We spoke about trains.
Trains.
You know how that goes.
Who doesn't like trains?
Gregor Smith loves trains.
Yeah.
Yeah. video games are a thing, though.
They are a thing.
They're a thing that we do at 10 o'clock at night.
Yeah.
Usually... This is not the latest we've started a podcast.
Well, it might be. If you consider the other ones more
earliest.
Early than late.
Yeah, okay.
Didn't we do one at about...
4 o'clock in the morning.
4 a.m., yeah.
Okay, no, this will be the latest we've ever started a podcast.
Yeah.
No, the Game of the Year stuff that never came out.
Oh, yeah.
That was pretty late.
Yeah.
Unusable. Thanks, Sam Gilbert. just call you out there.
Keep your damn pants on.
Yeah. Come on, man. How are the video games, Ollie?
The video games?
Yeah.
Well, as I said, there's a video game I have been playing.
So you've been playing this quite a bit.
I've been playing a mobile game. And I hate to admit that I've essentially just been spending a lot of time playing Flappy Bird.
Oh.
But it's not actually Flappy Bird.
No, it's a special edition.
It's Trump Dump.
Oh.
And it's inspiring me to play... Because I can drop a turd on Donald Trump's head at the end of...
That's a pretty good reason...
Yeah.
...to do stuff
I don't
like
play,
Flappy
I don't
Bird.
Play a lot of mobile games, but this has really captured my imagination. I'm having another go right now.
He's playing it live on the radio. Yeah,
live?
This week we aren't doing a video podcast because there's only two of us, and we need to be unvideoed.
It's just like old times.
You'll get a video version, sort of. It's just going to be on YouTube.
Yeah.
So bit.do/pixelshed, soundcloud.com/pixelshed, games-link.com for everything that
we
do.
We plugged at the end. Are we done?
We now plug at the start because people listen to the start but don't listen to the end.
Oh, okay. I just finished a level, and what you might notice is that
on this
each
video,
time I finish, I can just tap and you'll hear this very satisfying sound.
Excellent.
As I just...
So you were showing me this before. You said, like, I've actually been playing a video game, and I was, like, excited for, like, an actual video game, and it was Trump Dump, and I was like, that's the best video game.
Yeah.
But I think you're playing... Like, you say, like, the pooping on Donald Trump is an excellent thing, but I've noticed the better you do, the higher you have to get before you can poop on Donald Trump again.
Yeah, it's... It's just obviously, you know how Flappy Bird works, where it's like
the poles.
The poles.
Yeah.
And it's just when you first start the game, there's only one. You go through one, and every time you finish it, it just adds another one on.
Yeah.
I'm up to 31 now.
And yeah.
But also, the amount of poles, tube things you get through is also the amount of turds you drop on Trump. So now every time I finish one, I'll next be able to drop 32 poos on Donald Trump's head.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
That is the best news I've heard all week. And it's only Monday.
Yeah.
It's going to be the top news story
of the
week.
I don't think you're going
to top
that.
I'll submit it to Alex Daniel for Newsweek. Ollie Saville drops turds on Donald
Trump. So far I've dropped 31 poos on Donald Trump.
That's amazing.
That's an
impressive feat.
Well, no, I've dropped a lot more than that. I'm not going to work out the equation or whatever of how many I've dropped.
But you've dropped a lot.
I've dropped a lot.
I want to drop a lot of turds on Donald Trump.
Yeah.
I've been holding in a poo all day.
Especially just, for him.
Well, yeah, especially for him, but also because I haven't had the chance. Because I came into uni at like 2 o'clock, and it's like, that's in an inappropriate time to go for a poo. And it's coming in waves and stuff like that.
Oh.
You know when it's like, there's not there's just inappropriate times to go for a shit.
If I need to poo, I just poo.
Yeah, I will poo, like, on, you know, if
Nothing's
I need to go, but it's like, very high up lecturers within the university system, namely our chief benefactor, Jason Whitaker, was wandering around the corridors, and I didn't really want to go for a shit in case he went for a poo.
I mean, I've pooed next to a lecturer. I won't name names, but you know the story. I have heard the sounds of a lecturer in the cubicle next to me.
Yeah. Did you notice how I didn't say shit for Jason? Because, like, I don't think he shits like we do. We are monsters. It's not that he doesn't deserve the word shit. It's that, like, we don't deserve the word just...
We're not on the same level. Class.
I mean, I've been in the toilet after some of you guys, and good lord. Good lord. There's a reason those taps turn on the heat after 3 seconds to destroy whatever bacteria is left.
I'm a very clean person, actually.
I'm also incredibly clean. I will notice, like, oh shit, the skid marks in the toilet bowl. And some people will just leave them. But, like...
You'll be scrubbing it with a toothbrush.
I'm not scrubbing it with a toothbrush. That shit, it gets, there's, you know, whatever cups in the bathroom at the time or whatever. That boiling hot water goes in until all the shit stains have gone away. Because girls have to use that after me. I don't want them to know that I poo. They know I poo. I don't want to see what... I don't want... It's like a monster.
You're the only one there that poos.
It's like Picasso
in there. Girls
don't
poo.
It's like Picasso in there. I don't want that. I don't want them to see that. But poo, yeah. But I feel like you're also getting more and more addicted to Flappy Bird without noticing.
Oh, yeah, it's subliminally getting me to play Flappy Bird through the promise of shitting on that.
Yeah.
I was just racking my brain to think of some creative insult for Trump, but it was just...
It's just Trump. It's just Trump. He is an insult
looks
in
like
himself.
Looks like someone did a Trump.
I have played a more modern video game, though, than Flappy Bird.
Okay.
But, well, I guess Trump Dump is a modern video game.
Oh, yeah.
It's social commentary. it's an important video game. I will write an essay about it. Submit it to Ian Bogost's collection. That is a deep cut, I think, just went right over your head.
Absolutely.
Okay. I've been playing Street Fighter V.
Oh. Yeah, this doesn't sound positive.
So, I want to get into Street Fighter because I realized I don't have, like, the multiplayer game at the minute. I don't have something I can play
on
the TV.
You've got Destiny.
I don't. I have it.
It's there.
I want to forget that I have it. I think I left it at home deliberately. So, I got Street Fighter V because Bursary came in, and I was like, right, I've been waiting to buy something. I can either buy The Witness and Firewatch for the same price as Street Fighter V, but one Harley Everett went, yeah, but you can play Street Fighter over and over again, whereas The Witness will finish, and the Firewatch will be finished, and then you're done. And it's like, I'm like, okay, right, you have a fair point there. So I bought it, and we did some matches, you know, the fighting, like... The thing I'm starting to learn is, like, Zangief.
Yeah.
Because... So they've changed...
The Red Cyclone.
So there's two wrestlers in it this time around. There's Zangief and Rainbow Mika. She is the girl with... I think she's a new character, but might have appeared in a previous game.
Okay.
I want to say... I'm going to find out. I think she's from the Alpha series.
Okay.
So Street Fighter V takes place between 4 and 3.
Yeah.
So this is before Bison is dead. So the first game she was in was Street Fighter Alpha. Yeah, so there's two wrestlers. Rainbow Mika is more traditional wrestler girl thing. She has a big bum.
I just want to drop a little fact that I found out recently.
Oh?
It's to do with fighting games, not to do with Street Fighter. You know King in Tekken?
Yes.
You know who did the mocap for King?
Who did the mocap for
that
King?
That was Minoru Suzuki.
Oh.
As you may know from Mecha Mummy wrestling fame. Anyone who's not seen it, Minoru Suzuki versus Mecha Mummy. Look it up.
You have to watch it with Brian and Vinny's commentary because it is the best thing. Otherwise, it makes literally no sense.
It still makes no sense.
Like, oh my god. Fuck. So, but back on Street Fighter.
Yeah, just dropping little facts.
So Street Fighter, they've changed how, like, a majority of the moves are inputted and stuff like that.
Okay.
So my biggest issue with, like, Street Fighter in the past was, oh god, there are so many fucking combinations.
Yeah. Like, I've never been good at memorizing combos.
So a lot of the stuff now is quarter circle punch kicks.
Yeah.
Like, there are, you know, obviously, like, if you push forward on the stick and then press heavy punch, they're going to do a different punch to what they usually do.
Yeah.
But, like, a lot of the moves just follow on from, like, oh, this is just a backwards quarter circle, like, punch. Yeah. And I do this, and this, and this. So, it makes a lot of the... It makes learning characters a hell of a lot easier. Like, it okay. feels like I can jump in with anybody and maybe pull something cool off.
Yeah, see, in Street Fighter 4, I only ever really learnt two characters, and they were Blanca and El Fuerte.
Mm-hmm.
Which are my two favourite characters.
So I only ever learnt Zangief in Street Fighter 4, and I was shite with him. The only reason I could learn him okay. is because he was a full circle turn on the stick,
yeah.
and then a punch, and he does a grab.
No, it's the spinning lariat.
The spinning well. Lariat is now just a button.
Oh, okay.
So it's just a button. You can
pretty
now.
Much just spam that with Zangief.
Yeah, like his super move is V trigger. That's what it is. It's the V trigger.
Oh.
So there's like.
So it's finisher.
Sort of. You can pop the V trigger whenever you want in the match because each character has like a different thing. Okay. So like Zangief's is like okay, no, he does the cyclone nonstop. For the as long as you right. hold the button and have the V trigger, so it's like the V trigger, and then there's a blue bar underneath, which is like this is a stronger version of this move that you will do.
Yeah.
So, you know, Zangief's like super move is, he does a German suplex so hard he pushes them into the ground. but like he puts his face super fucking close up to the screen and he's like, I am strongest. Yes. And then, like, throws them backwards. And so I almost fell out my chair there.
You just wait till WrestleMania. That's going to be Brock Lesnar's it's super pretty, finisher.
It's pretty much Brock Lesnar-like. They've turned him into Brock Lesnar. so, I'm learning Zangief sort of because he's simple.
Yeah.
He hurts a lot, and he's just a lot of grabs. So, he's annoying.
Yeah, see, I don't know who I'd play if I did.
So, there's not a lot of characters this time around. Yeah, they've lowered the character count.
As I said, I played El Fuerte
he's not
and
in
Blanca,
it.
And neither of them are in
neither
it.
Neither of them in it. So it's... I want to say the roster... I'm trying to remember off the top of my head. Like, returning characters is like Ryu, Ken.
I know Vega's in it.
Oh, hang on,
because, I've
got the characters.
Because I did play Vega when I tried it at EGX.
Yeah, so returning characters are Cammy... Charlie Knight. Oh wait, they're all kind of returning characters.
Yeah.
The only new ones are Fong. Fong, Nakali, Rashid, the new ones. But they all so the nice thing about it is like I think like some characters will be, you know, will obviously be a bit more difficult to learn in
yeah.
comparison to other stuff. Like, I think M. Bison has a bit more of a complex
okay.
thing. It's good, though. The fighting's good.
Yeah.
It feels nice. Online, when the servers work and I have a decent connection, so if I'm wired in, if the PS4's wired in to the Ethernet, it runs, like, as if the person's in the next room. Like, it's sat next to me.
Yeah.
Servers... I've not noticed a lot of drop in, like, when
okay.
they fixed them, but, like, you can tell when, like, the Americans are coming because the servers just die on their ass. So I've, like, noticed, like, between, like, 2 and 5 o'clock in the morning are really good times, and roughly the afternoon's good times for the UK, and then the Americans pop on, and it's like,
yeah.
oh, everything's dead. So the fighting's good. I like some of the characters. I'm leaning towards, like, Zangief and Armika. Mostly because they're wrestlers and they
oh,
look
yeah.
cool. Like, Armika, like, is just really fucking cool. I busted out my arcade stick
Oh, okay.
My PS3 arcade stick.
Oh, is it? Does it work with it? Then?
So I was worried because like Reddit put together like because I was checking like the Street Fighter Reddit just to see what the servers were like, and then I realized why am I checking Reddit for this? These guys are unreliable. I'll just check Twitter, the official Twitter feed for the Street Fighter servers, which they've actually made this time round. And so I was checking that, and then I thought, oh, actually, the thing Reddit will be more honest about is what sticks will work. Oh, because like they've obviously tried that, like people have tried them and stuff like that, and people were like, "Oh, what about the Mad Catz Collector's Edition?" So I was like searching for like the Mad Catz Collector's Edition 20th Anniversary Collector's Edition stick that I got from eBay for £40 instead of the oodles of money they were asking for. And someone said like, "If it's set in this mode, it might work. If it's not set in this mode, you know, it might work. It might not." And I was like, "Well, it's just kind of the same parts inside as the." Big sticks that they put out for the PS3 and Xbox 360, the tournament edition sticks. It's just the same parts. It's just on, you know. And I plugged it in, and it turns out it works perfectly fine. The PS4 has a weird system, though, where it's like you need a DualShock 4 on at all times.
Right.
For it to recognize. So, like, it.
Kind of like. So, sort of like the. We talked about with the Wii and Guitar Hero. Need the Wii controller on.
Yeah, so like,
host it.
Yeah, pretty much. Pretty much the same idea, except like, this should just work off the bat. Like, I shouldn't need to keep a DualShock 4 on. It should just recognize it as a USB device and go through with it. Yeah. But then again, it's like, all right. That means like Xbox 360 controllers would work on PS4 as well. It's just not something they're up for, you know. So you like set like in the settings, it's like legacy control. So I'm glad that that works. I'm still trying to learn how to use an arcade stick after all this time. I can use an arcade stick in arcade games, like you know, like actual arcade games and stuff like that, perfectly fine. The problem with Street Fighter V that a lot of people have said already is that game is hollow as fuck unless you are ready to play it online.
Pretty much unfinished by the sound of things.
Yeah, so in March there is going to be a free update.
Yep.
Which will, so basically it's just going to be a load of free updates before the DLC starts hitting.
Yeah.
The DLC starts hitting next month.
Okay.
So like Giant Bomb was saying, like the thing that you usually do to learn each character is usually like whatever story mode they've got in place.
Yeah.
Arcade mode, etc., etc., etc. That's not there. Barely. Right. It's barely there. The story mode, there's a story mode. It, you choose a character, takes you through some poorly drawn cutscenes. Like still images.
Oh, yeah.
Like you know, like
still at with the that end, then.
Yeah, like but like throughout with voice acting and stuff like that. And it's nice to hear the characters with some actual life to them and stuff like that. And then when they start the match, they'll interact with each other and stuff.
Okay.
Kind of like Mortal Kombat did with its story mode.
Yeah.
Where it was like at the start of the matches, but like that thing that they are ripping Mortal Kombat off on, the like cinematic story expansion or whatever they're calling it, is coming not till June or July.
Oh, okay.
And that's what I would be using to learn these characters, like. The so tutorial
you pretty much just got to jump into online with.
Yeah.
I mean, you can do training, can't you?
You can do training, but it's like, all right, but the CPU is like either brain dead or too difficult for me to pull anything off. And there's no CPU versus CPU in the versus mode. You always need to be fighting someone. So it's like you can.
That's what seems a bit ridiculous.
Yeah. Like, survival mode seems to be where it's at if you want to learn how to fucking fight people.
Yeah.
But once you get past like normal mode,
it seem pretty impossible just to learn.
Just to
turn it on
and play.
Have a fight and then turn it off.
Yeah, which is like, what I got it for.
Yeah.
Like I just want to fight the CPU at this point. Like I will go online I've gone online 3 or 4 times at this point. And I've had my ass handed to me every single time. But like it's not. It's only because like they've changed the move set, like the inputs and stuff, in such a way that I can now, you know, hold my own because everything's pretty much the same. I just need to remember which way to turn the stick. I need to learn to block because Christ, I can't. Oops, excuse me. I can't block. I can't block for shit. I keep forgetting that blocking is a thing. Like, I'll remember it too late.
Yeah.
But they've changed a bunch of systems. Like Street Fighter V, you can't just kill people by chip damage anymore. Okay. So, like, you know, people play footsies and try to get the last chip of health off.
Yeah.
You need to fully strike them. Like, you can't... So, like, one person would be blocking and they'd just be hammering on them. And it's like, no, that's not going to work anymore. Like, they'll... I've not tried Nash yet. I've not tried... Which is basically, like, Guile's friend.
Oh, yeah.
He sort of plays like Guile, but he's not Guile.
Yeah.
Guile is going to be DLC. I've got a load of fight money from doing story modes and survivals.
Right.
And there's costumes to unlock. The shop isn't there. The thing I want to, like, I want to buy costumes for the characters. I want to razzle dazzle everyone up. Ryu looks a bit boring in either white or blue or green.
But he's got a beard now.
Only if you pre-ordered it.
Really?
Yeah.
That was the pre-order bonus.
I think it
was. Facial hair.
I think the bearded Ryu was pre-order, and you'll be able to buy it in the shop.
Oh.
What
a bonus.
What a bonus. But, like, it's good. Like, what's there is really fucking good.
Yeah.
And I understand why they've put it out now, which is basically to meet with their esports scene.
Oh.
Like, yeah. That's what this is for. This is the game, if anyone wants to get into Street Fighters, like, seriously, this is it. You get in now.
Yeah.
And, you know, put some effort in, and you will...
Not suck.
I mean, proof in the pudding is 3 weeks of training. That hip-hop artist, Lupe Fiasco... beat Daigo live on the internet.
Oh.
Yeah, did you not see this?
No.
This we spoke about this last week.
Okay.
No. Fiasco called out Daigo.
Yeah.
Like, I can beat you at Street Fighter. Mad Catz organized it because Mad Catz sponsored Daigo.
Yeah.
And Daigo lost, like, cleanly. Like, okay, it looked like he was throwing a couple matches and stuff like that, you know, just to amp up the tension and stuff. Because he's a showman. You know, he's got to put on a show.
Sure, this isn't, like, the WrestleMania guests incident. This isn't Floyd Mayweather versus the Big Show.
No. This is legit, like, Daigo...
We've got to put the big name over.
Yeah, but no. Like, Daigo started to bring it back. And then legit lost in the last match, and it was amazing. The whole thing was outstanding, even though it lasted only half an hour.
Yeah.
But, like, it's proof in the pudding is, like, okay, sure, he went and played, like, Street Fighter 3, and he probably did it 3 weeks straight and whatever like that.
Yeah.
But I guess if I did it 3 weeks straight, I would be pretty good at Street Fighter as well. Like, the point that I'm going to probably test, like, what my Street Fighter skills are like is when Jacob comes back.
Oh, yeah.
Because I'm sure that'll be off.
I've played Jacob on Street Fighter.
Yeah. Like, Jacob
I don't enjoy Street Fighter anymore.
No.
Jacob's not fun to play against.
No, because he knows his shit.
Yeah. I don't like people that know how to play the game.
Which is why I'm playing... Which is why I bought it now, so that I get, like, a leg up. Like, Jacob will be the point... Because it's like, I'm playing... Like, I played against...
The measuring stick.
Yeah, like, I played against Harley. Me and Harley have, like... You know, are on the same level. We're busting, mashing like fuck.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And then I started pulling off, like, actual moves and learning stuff. And then she knows Chun-Li, etc., etc. So it's like, at some point, we found an even playing field.
Yeah.
But with Jacob, that's when it's like, okay, I'm throwing myself in the deep end here. I'm gonna... But Jacob's, like, super humble about it.
Fucking
like,
nerd.
Yeah, like... I'm trying to think what else I've played this week. I've been looking at stuff, and it's just like, I want to play all these things, but maybe not.
Yeah.
Like, the next thing is probably Far Cry Primal.
Yeah. See, I've been thinking of buying that. I don't know if I'll buy I might end up buying it tomorrow.
Yeah, it comes out.
Tomorrow
yeah. I was looking at it, and then I was also looking at The Witness again.
Oh, okay.
I'm really interested in seeing what The Witness is like. Just simply because I think it would be. I'm trying to lean into, like, this year. I'm trying to like lean into genres that I don't usually play. Like,
yeah.
Fighting games. I've not neglected them. The only reason I've neglected them is because it's only until now. Yeah.
See, I've kind of done the same thing with XCOM.
Yeah.
So I've never
really gone into strategy.
Yeah.
And stuff.
Never really played. Obviously, it's not an RTS, but I've never really touched.
Yeah, you never touched that type of strategy game.
Yeah.
How is XCOM 2 going?
I still suck.
Yeah.
It's still incredibly difficult, and I've still not made much more progress.
Well, I saw a load of the reviewers bumped it down to easy just to get through it.
Yeah. See, I'm still putting off on doing that. I don't want to, because I feel like that's kind of part of the enjoyment. But they released an update, because there was a lot of performance issues with it. And I was managing to run it on high, but not on ultra before, and I was getting solid 60 frames per second. After this update, I've managed to max it out, but it now only runs at 30 frames per second.
Oh.
So I've kind of had the choice of going down to high, and getting it at 60.
You aren't the first person to say, like, yeah, I've got a super beefy PC and it's running like fucking shite.
Yeah, see, I've gone with having all the graphical stuff maxed out and having it at 30 frames per second, because
it doesn't make that much.
Yeah,
of a
because
difference.
For the kind of game it is, graphics.
It would be nice to run it in 60, just for like.
But if it's a choice between graphics, and 30 or lesser graphics and 60, the graphics are a lot more noticeable than the frame rate, I think, because. You spend so much of that game standing still and just
looking. You want it to look nice.
Yeah, and just looking around the area.
Yeah, I'm sure they're gonna make my move. Like, so, I'm sure someone's out there. Like, hey, I've got the same build. Here's what I did to get 60 and run it on max settings. There's a story here at the top on GameSpot. Someone's put Star Wars into XCOM 2.
Okay.
So you can go in as stormtroopers, I guess. It's a game that will elude me for a while.
Yeah.
Because it's not coming.
Still.
It's not coming to consoles.
No. Is it definitely never coming to consoles?
There's a heavy focus on modding.
Oh, yeah.
This time around, so they want.
I've not really done much with the modding. I've mainly done it for customization stuff.
Yeah.
Just getting more clothes.
The most handy one I've seen is like, yeah, here's your actual chance to, like, they've changed it from like chance to hit to chance to miss.
Yeah.
So that seems like it's utilities at the minute.
Yeah.
There's gonna probably be like.
And the other thing was a full 360 rotation, because at the moment it's just you rotate the battlefield 4 times. So you keep having to scan like that.
But a lot of someone pointed out, like, you can mod the game yourself without actually like modding. You know, like what you'd think modding is.
Yeah.
There's the .ini file.
Right.
Is completely alterable. So if you're like some people have been like changing it. So like, yeah, it's one shot, one kill.
Yeah.
Towards me, but reduce poison damage. Etc. Like changing the figures, seeing what they do.
Yeah.
Obviously the sharpshooter like will be able to hit 100% with a pistol.
Yeah.
Like it hits 100% with my sniper rifle. Why would it be on 85% for a pistol?
Hey, there are those irritating moments when you stood right next to them and you like literally right next to them, and it's like 90% chance to hit.
Yeah. It's like well, why the
even
fuck
that
time
what. How can you... You've got a shotgun, and you're stood next to them. How can you miss?
The gun is literally inside them.
Yeah.
Because
I've been affected by that 10%.
Yeah.
And it is the most...
Irritating.
Oh.
Annoying.
It's seriously frustrating, to say the least.
So, I'm looking through the news, and there is a Gears of War Ultimate Edition mandatory patch.
Okay. That does what?
I am looking at this article right now, and I'm going to analyze it while keeping talking to you, right, so that the conversation carries on flowing while I look for what it actually does inside of this press release that they've rewritten. It's gonna fix things like the boom shot hit registration and matchmaking time.
Yeah.
It's 5 gigabytes big.
Okay. I'm not sure I can even fit that on my console.
It's gonna change things up, such as kills in social playlists that will now count towards the game's seriously achievement. Previously, only kills in competitive mode counted towards the challenge, which is awarded to you when you kill 10,000
players.
Yeah,
I only really played the social playlist because the competitive one is just like execution modes where there's no respawns.
Yeah.
And that's what it was in the original Gears of War. There was no standard team deathmatch with respawns, but they put it in it now, so that's all I really want. Because you know what? I die a lot.
Yep, you want to play.
I just want to shoot shit, die, and get up and shoot shit again. Yeah.
Like you, I think both of us have realised that we are no longer ready for, like, we're no longer the audience for Twitch games.
Oh, no, I'm...
Which is weird that I'm trying to get into Street Fighter, and it's like, it's like...
I'm not a search and destroy kind of guy.
No, never have been.
No.
Like, that was, like, my friends would always play Call of Duty 4 and would be like, we're doing Search and Destroy, or Modern Warfare 2 it was.
Yeah.
We're doing Search and Destroy. I'm like, fuck Search and Destroy. It's terrible. Why would you want to die once in this game where you can get shot once and die?
Yeah.
Like, but then it's, like, weird because over Christmas I played a little bit of Counter-Strike Go, and it's like, I like this, but I'm no good at shooting people.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is pretty much what you just said. Like, execution mode is a mode that can be highly rewarding, but also extremely punishing, the Coalition said. To better reward players who take the challenge of execution, we've increased the XP gain of the mode significantly. So okay. Basically, hey, you're going to reach that level 100 or whatever it is.
That's fair.
So, VR is a thing.
VR is a thing.
It's a thing that's a thing. It's coming on the way. It's on its way. Vive. HTC Vive.
HTC.
Valve's headset.
Yeah.
Is got its price. At a smooth $800.
Oh.
I think.
Oh.
I want to say.
That's not smooth. You said smooth. You didn't mean smooth.
So, yeah, $799. Ships early April. And you can answer phone calls in VR.
Great.
Never leave. Strap this to your head with duct tape. We'll pop a food tube in you. We're almost there. Judge Dredd 2000 AD Mega City 1. Almost there. So I was looking at it and like Michael Pachter piped up. Like $800, $600, $800 for the Vive, $600 for the Oculus Rift. And now it's Sony's turn with the PlayStation VR.
Oh, yeah.
But someone said, like, yeah, because that worked out so well for, like, Palm Pre and BlackBerry when they were, like, BlackBerry was, like, $199. I can't remember who said it. I'll have to try and find it. The thing is, this is not... What people forget about VR is it's not just video games.
Yeah.
Video games are a part of it, like mobile phones. It's new tech.
The one thing that stood out to me was like the sports events. I think WWE was actually one that was trialing it.
Yes.
It was like the kind of front row seat view.
Well, Rihanna also has tried it with her latest album.
Right.
So like there's a new room or whatever to explore per song or whatever.
Okay.
You know, things.
Yeah.
Just looking up this tweet. But like what people don't realize is there needs to. It's like iPhones and stuff like that, like with like smartphones and stuff, it's going to take a while for people to adopt them and stuff like that. Like, it could die on its fucking ass.
Yeah.
Almost immediately. Like, but early adapters, you know, people are saying, like, I'm just basically like repeating what people have said and stuff like that. Like, early adapters and stuff like that are. They're going to either praise it or shit all over it. And those who praise it will, you know, convince a fair few people.
See, the thing I was mentioning with VR is, so they've got those cameras that they're trialing on, like, front row seats on sports events.
Yes. And that
seems like a kind of cool idea, just sitting there and watching it from everyone, the front row,
like, everyone
instead
in
of
the same
the
position. Like, WWE just need to stick a fucking camera on the side of the barriers.
Yeah. It's just, but the one thing I'm thinking with that is you're always going to get whatever fan is sat behind that camera or next to that camera is going to be looking into it and shouting into it for the whole thing. So you're going to be sat there with your headset on and you're just going to see this fat guy in a John Cena shirt going, hey, hey!
What was that guy?
You're all enjoying the match!
The guy with the sign.
What sign?
The Daniel who put it in front of Daniel Bryan.
Oh, Jack Thinned.
Yeah.
In front of the camera.
Yeah, like, Michael Pachter is like, yeah, Sony will dominate at $500, probably, at sub-$500. They might do. They might not. Because the iPhone was the most expensive smartphone on the planet for a while, and look where we are now. Where's BlackBerry? Yeah. Where's Palm Pre? I'm moderately excited for VR. I'm also absolutely fucking terrified for it.
Something I want to try.
Yeah, I'm just scared that it's going to ruin my eyes even further.
Yeah.
It's
something that I want to try and I like the novelty of, but I don't want it to take over. Because
it'll never take over. Yeah, exactly. It was the same
fear people had with motion control when Kinect came out. Like, is this going to take over? Are they going to force this
and
upon
motion
us?
Motion control's still there because VR is going to be using it.
Yeah.
But it, at the same time, like, if VR is going to dominate, which some people want it to dominate.
Yeah.
It's not yet.
Right.
It won't be for a few years.
Mm-hmm.
There will be many an indie project working on this game. There will be many a thing working on this game. What, etc., etc., etc. Like, there will be lots of little things. But it's not going to dominate for a while.
No.
It's going to take a few years. And early adopters are going to feel a bit scorned in some cases, because the Oculus Rift isn't what I expected it to be, the quality isn't there, whatever it is, and then the next one will come out in a few years and it'll be like, well, shit. And then we'll be like, we got the new Oculus Rift, it's amazing. Oh my god, I only spent £200 on it, it was amazing. I'm playing the next video game, Call of Duty, pow, 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 pow.
And that's how we talk,
that's who we are. I'm just like looking at news and stuff like that. Oh, so you know those Halo microtransactions you keep not doing?
Yeah, they've raised a lot of money.
1.5 million at least.
Oh, you poor suckers. You know how I've avoided not paying for them?
How?
Not playing Halo.
Have you just dropped off?
I've not played Halo in quite some time.
I think since the stream.
Yeah, that is probably the last time.
So, 4 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago.
Yeah. Well, I'll probably go back to it at some point, maybe when
Griffball comes out.
Yeah, maybe when they stick some more maps in again, I'll try that out.
It seems like the maps they're putting out, a lot of them look...
They all seem to be Forge maps, and... Yeah, they don't always look that nice. I mean, they might be fun to play.
But, yeah.
But, yeah.
Yeah, that's sort of the reaction.
Give me more than just Forge maps, and then I'll get back into it.
Yeah. Speaking of seeing as we spoke about Street Fighter, the more important fighting game is on the way. In Pokken Tournament.
Oh, yes.
Pokken Tournament, I've watched some gameplay of that.
Yeah?
It looks good.
It does look good.
It looks good. But they've taken away like all the weaknesses and stuff like that with like support characters. I was watching like a Pikachu fight a Blaziken.
Yeah.
And they had a Snivy and a Lapras.
Okay.
As their support squad.
Yeah.
And I was like, just use the fucking Lapras because they put Blaziken down in seconds.
Type advantages.
Yeah. And they use the Snivy, or Snivy, whatever you want to call it. Snivy went out and did the same amount of damage as the Lapras.
Right.
I watched the last boss fight Dark Mewtwo. And Pokemon Company or Game Freak, whoever is in charge of this, is being very wibbly wobbly on whether it's canon or not. So we might see a Dark Mewtwo in the next game.
Yeah, I've kind of thought if the next one is going to be Pokemon Z or Z, or then obviously we had Mega Mewtwo X and Mega Mewtwo Y, so maybe we'll get Mega Mewtwo Z and that'll be Dark Mewtwo.
Yeah.
Because I like the design of it and stuff. It just looks
like Frieza.
It looks really cool.
It looks like a Dragon Ball Z character. but yeah, like I'm looking forward to it because it's like a lot of people commenting like, this is why I always wanted Pokemon Battles to be. Yeah. And it's like, no, you do not want this on a 3DS.
You don't want this in the main games, no.
You do not want this on a 3DS. You want this on a Wii U. It's going to be nice to play for a few hours, and then I'll put it down, and I'll go, that was nice, and I'll forget about it. Probably like Street Fighter V in a couple months. but yeah, I'm oddly looking forward to Pokken Tournament.
Yeah, see, it was one of those games that I was planning to buy a Wii U, and I was probably going to get that with it, that and Zelda.
Mm. But now it's like,
probably not going to buy a Wii U.
Considering the NX possibly might come out this year, and it's like, will the NX support Wii U backwards compatibility? And if it does, then what's the fucking point in buying a Wii U?
Yeah, I'm
unless it's like the NX doesn't come with support for the, like, you need a Wii U gamepad already to play Pokken Tournament or whatever it is. I don't know. Things are weird with Nintendo at the minute. I was looking at the new Quantum. Is it Quantum Dreams? They're called the Alan Wake developers. Oh, the new game.
Quantum Break.
Quantum Break. What are they called? They're called Remedy.
Yeah.
Quantum Break. The game. The game's called Quantum Break, and from Remedy. I was looking at it, and I was like, "What the fuck is this?" Oh yeah, it's got a TV show attached to it.
Yeah.
So in between like levels or whatever it is, you will set your controller down and you will watch a 22-minute show which will explain the bad guy side. And then you will pick the game back up and you will play
the repercussions
of the thing.
If the show is actually any good, then this...
I am worried that the show will be better than the actual game, and I'll be like playing the game like in spite of myself, just to... I trust Remedy with shooting and stuff like that.
See, I'm just thinking, like, I feel like this might be just a dodgy tie-in and just not be a very good show, and I'm just thinking, just give me cutscenes. I would rather have cutscenes.
Well, that's the thing. They're like, you'll still get your cutscenes and stuff like that.
I would rather have it all through cutscenes.
Yeah. I don't want to be forced into watching the show.
Yeah.
I would maybe rather enjoy, like, because if it's like meant to be a mystery of what's the fuck's going on, I don't want the show spoiling like what the level coming up is going to be like.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, you'll be fighting the repercussions of like the episode and stuff like that.
Right.
But what if I just want to see the game through from one side and then put the pieces together through the series myself?
Yeah.
Like, I don't play the Half-Life with direct commentary on the
It seems like they're trying to do something new and inventive.
Yeah, which is cool. When, like, go for it. Yeah. But don't make me sit through a 20-minute show.
At the end of the day, I just want to play a video game.
Will it be skippable? Will it not?
Yeah. I'm not sure. I mean, yeah, if these are actually really well made, well produced, and it's actually good acting and stuff, that's the main thing I'm thinking.
Well, there's actual actors playing the thing is Sam Lake's script.
Right.
Which has worked for Max Payne 1 and 2, because it was like, oh, it's a super noir, like, oh, it's comic book writing. Ooh, yeah. It's a bit bad. There's some of the writing and stuff like that, but it passes because it's the early 2000s and anything can pass for writing. Alan Wake had all right writing, but there's a lot of dumb fucking moments.
I like Alan Wake.
But yeah, Alan Wake's like actual story was well written and stuff like that. But like when you read like some of the horror, like the notes and stuff like that, and it's like, oh god, this is tripe, and it's like a weird mixture between, was this supposed to be good, or is like Alan Wake just the Stephanie Meyer of Alan Wake's world? Like, does he write just Twilight books, or do they genuinely think this is Stephen King levels of good? And if 4 days ago, this is hot news, Assassin's Creed may not have yearly releases when it returns. So it's skipping this year.
Good.
It's skipping this year to give the movie breathing room.
It never should have. Honestly. Yeah, breathing room is exactly what it needed. It's been overdone to the point where, when Assassin's Creed, like, okay, this is going back a while, but the first Assassin's Creed, I absolutely loved the concept of it, and I love the game, and I played Assassin's Creed 2 as well, and really enjoyed that.
Assassin's Creed 2 is what Assassin's Creed 1 wanted to be without doing the same shit over and over again.
Yeah.
Assassin's Creed 1 was the nice... Assassin's Creed 1 was the mirror's edge of the Assassin's Creed series. It was a nice experiment that wasn't too great when you think back on it.
See, it was a flawed
experiment.
Yeah.
Assassin's Creed 2 was the, here's how it's meant to be done. But and then Brotherhood was like, we've refined this. And then Revelations was, we've lost our way a little bit. Like, the gameplay is perfectly fine and stuff like that, but he's done this before.
He was just overdone.
Yeah. Like, when 3 came out, and I was like, I don't think I've ever finished 3.
Right. You know,
Three came out, and I was like, oof, no thanks. I just finished Revelations.
I'm so sick of the whole sci-fi subplot. I never liked it, even in the first one. If this game is supposed to be some kind of historical tourism,
yeah,
you let me see all these historical locations, then stop fucking telling me that I'm in a computer, and let me actually be in these locations.
Yeah, like, they've kind of pulled back on that by essentially...
They pulled back on it.
In 4, they pulled back on it.
Yeah, they pulled back on it, but they just...
But that's also to give them, like, context behind, like, the UI and, you know...
Yeah,
but
that's...
Again, it's video games, who cares?
Yeah, exactly. Who cares? Stop telling me that I'm in a simulation.
Would you
How can I
like
really be invested in a world?
Ditch the simulations in favour of going for a futuristic Assassin's Creed?
I would be... open to a modern day or futuristic one.
Without simulation?
Yeah.
Unless it's a simulation from the future of the past. Again, but it's our time.
but I would also be open to another historical game where I'm simply part of this assassin's guild or whatever, and I'm just an assassin, not the descendant of an assassin reliving memories.
Yeah.
Just let me be an assassin and actually be in this place, not in a computer recreation of this fucking place.
Yeah, you wanna be the actual...
That's the one thing that has put me off the whole series.
Yeah.
Because I just... I can't get...
The thing is, I treat the game like you want. When I played the Ezio trilogy...
Yeah.
The only point I played Desmond is when it forced me to play Desmond.
Yeah.
I forgot I was in the simulation until, like, you know, you're pulled into the loading screens and stuff like that. And even then, it's just like, oh, this just looks like a loading screen.
Yeah.
Like, it's just running around in a blank space. Or when it would rebuild the world and it's like, oh, yeah, simulation stuff. Sorry, I made myself yawn. And now I'm yawning over and over again. I've caught it myself. You
made yourself yawn talking about these fucking simulations.
Yeah. But, like, I still hold, like, Assassin's Creed 2 as maybe one of my favourite games of all time.
Yeah, you know,
Brotherhood, I don't hold in such a high regard because it was just a refinement on perfection.
You know what would have made Assassin's Creed 2 better? If you were actually in Rome!
True.
Or Florence, or wherever the fuck
Florence,
it is.
Yeah. Oh, Assassin's Creed 2 is so good, though. It was so good. You fight the Pope. You punch the Pope in the face with a golden apple.
The whole series should have been about this is how this Assassin's Guild has evolved over time, and this
well,
is not they're all descended together by fine, they can be descended together by a bloodline, but don't have me sat in a fucking fish tank or whatever I'm in.
See, I like some of that aspect because I was expecting the third game to go, alright, now you're Desmond. He's learnt from the best.
Yeah, that
in the simulations.
That would have made sense.
And that was the whole point. But then they fucked it. Because 3 wasn't that game.
Yeah.
3 was like, we've recreated this world. And it's like, yeah, but you've chosen literally the worst time in the world to put an Assassin's Creed game in.
Yep.
Because everything is flat because it's America. Nothing has been... There's no huge cities. Like, even now, it's like, where would you set an Assassin's Creed game?
Wasn't there rumors about the Egyptian one?
Yes.
Or there was something about an Egyptian game leaked.
Yeah.
Made by Ubisoft leaked, and the rumors that it might be the next.
So that was a reboot of Prince of Persia.
Oh, is that what it was?
I think that was meant to be a Prince of Persia game.
Confirmation.
Yeah, it was a Prince of Persia game, but developed by the Assassin's Creed team.
Right.
Which developed.
Because that was said to be like open world.
Yeah, so you were meant to be like, here's an assassin within Egypt, and that's supposedly the next game, but maybe not.
So
because Syndicate came out.
Yeah. If they wanted to do a Prince of Persia game like that, I'd be all for that. I really like the Prince of Persia world.
But the thing about the Prince of Persia was that it's slightly cartoony.
Yeah.
And it worked. But I don't want a super
serious
Prince
like Warrior Persia. Within and Two Thrones. I really like both of them.
I prefer the first one because it is like
I did like the first
this
one.
This is the most video gamey video game.
Yeah.
The other ones were, oh god, the whole Dark Prince thing was like, ugh, no thanks.
Yeah, I enjoyed it. I like those games.
I just think I don't hold them as a high reverence as like other people
because
I never really finished them. They were touch and go games.
Yeah.
For me.
See, it was
because I was GameCube, so it's like I got the first one and the second one, but the third one
right.
I don't think ever came out.
Right.
I think it's meant to come
out
on Wii.
It was a trilogy that I really enjoyed. I had it on the original Xbox, and I'd be all for it if you were to give me an open world Assassin's Creed-y kind of game set in that world.
No, Prince of Persia 3 did come out on GameCube.
Right.
Oh, it came out on fucking everything. It came out on PlayStation 3 and Xbox.
Yeah.
It came out on PlayStation 3. Christ. Oh, wait, no. It was a different version for the Wii. What was Prince... I want to find out what Prince of Persia Rival Swords.
Oh, yeah.
Is that just like...
I remember that being a thing.
Whoops, Swords. What is this? So yeah, no.
Yeah, it was a port to PSP and Wii.
Yeah.
It was basically the same game.
Okay. Okay. So here is the last bit of news that we will talk about, which is Hideo Kojima got his little award at the DICE Awards.
Yeah.
But no one went to pick up the MGS5 Best Adventure Game Award. Mm-hmm. Kojima just came off the stage like a bit like a few minutes beforehand, like after receiving the Hall of Fame Award. And because he's under, like, such legal stress with Metal Gear and stuff, yeah, like Konami, and no one from Konami showed up. So, like, whoever was on stage just collected it for the company. It was like, I guess. But yeah, no, I'm... Oh! That's what I saw today. Arbiter in Killer Instinct.
Oh, yeah.
They put that trailer out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Not played Killer Instinct.
It will be free. Well, Arbiter isn't, but the game is.
Okay.
So you can just download that and play.
Sure.
And buy Arbiter. And learn the Arbiter.
The ways of the Arbiter.
Yeah. Oh, here's March's first free PlayStation game plus. PlayStation Plus game. Free. It's going to be Broforce.
Yay. A game I don't know on a console I don't own. That says it all.
Yeah. The other two... So, Broforce was competing against... So, it was one of Sony's, like, vote for the game that's going to be PlayStation Plus. So, yeah. It was Action Hank, Broforce, and Assault Android Cactus.
Oh, yeah.
So, they definitely chose the wrong one. Because Assault Android Cactus was there. And then Curve Digital, which is the publisher of Hank, Action Hank.
Yeah.
Just posted one tweet with a link saying, for fuck's sake.
Fair enough.
Fair enough. Right. That's a podcast.
Yeah.
It's a short one in comparison. Do you think we can get it?
To the lack of Jacob.
It's due to the lack of Jacob. We're going to have to talk to Jacob.
He's the glue that holds us together.
So the screen has burnt in and I can just see like 6 mice all over the place. I've been Joel Owens. Thank you, Ollie Saville.
You're welcome.
We're going to record one more promo or maybe a couple more promos.
Ooh, yeah. Oh,
yeah. I'm the cream. I've not bought any cream. We'll have to go get some cream tomorrow and do it. I'll get a camera out. We'll do some cream. If you are listening from the University of Lincoln, I am running in the student elections. So go look at my manifesto. If you think I'm okay, support me. That'd be nice. All right.
Do that.
Bye.
Yeah.
Under an hour.